Ladies and gentlemen, if you'll stand with us, we'll have our pledge to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. Christiansburg Town Council is now in session. Be aware that we are wired for sound now and that the microphones are on. If there's a problem out there with noise, just let me know. We can tweak it a little bit. And occasionally, our video man in the back is going to have to change tape. So when he gives me a signal, we'll need to stop and give him a chance to do what he needs to do. You have copies of the minutes from the last meeting. And I hope you've had an opportunity to read over those minutes. And at this time, we'll ask for any additions or corrections to the minutes.
I move that the minutes be approved as presented.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the minutes. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. This evening we have Planning Commission's recommendations on several requests that came to us in the last several weeks in form of public hearings. And at this time I'm going to ask, I don't see our chairman here.
Craig's not here, not really prepared, but I can tell you what we decided on.
Okay. This is Kevin Connor of the Planning Commission.
I don't have anything formal to read, but I can go down the list just with their recommendations and how the votes happen. On the first one, the request by Selco Partnership, this was to change the zoning ordinance to allow, we changed the few things in the ordinance regarding that, and there was a vote of 5-0 to recommend approval with 2 abstentions.
And this was to amend the Charter 30, yes, which would allow the telecommunication structure,
yes,
which,
yes,
is higher, I believe, than...
Yeah, it went from 75 to 125 feet.
So the recommendation is to approve
the changes.
In the same form as it came to the Planning Commission?
Do we have any changes limitations yesterday? I don't think we had any changes yesterday.
I'd like to know for sure if you'll vote on it or discuss it.
Randy was here.
It was at 125 feet, and the change he made was there was a second reference in the ordinance under the lighting and aesthetics that made a reference to the 70 foot, and the change he made was to make that consistent with the height in the definition, which is the new 125 foot.
Right.
In contingent upon the approval of the first request, and the second request is for a conditional use permit.
Mr. Mayor, the recommendation was a 5-1 vote, I believe. I don't have my numbers in front of me. 5-1 with 2 abstentions to recommend approval of the conditional use permit with the conditions we had yesterday. I don't believe we made any changes to that. There were some additional conditions that the applicant had brought forward to us. I think under number 3 or 4, it was like A, B, C, D. There were some additional ones that were from the original public hearing.
Sure, and I can. Yeah, said I wasn't prepared to do that.
Yeah, on number 3. The applicant added A, B, C, and D just for a little little
you
clarification.
Could read those,
yes,
for us.
Okay. I can read that. Do you want me to go down the whole list or just the third one?
Please go down the whole list,
okay,
but not all of us have heard the conditions.
Okay. Condition number 1, the structure is limited to 125 feet in total height, and that there actually should be an additional language to that, from the adjacent grade. So it wasn't 125 feet from the lowest or the highest point on the site. It was from the adjacent grade next to the pole. So just to clarify that. The structure is to be a monopole design and designed to be collapsible on a maximum area no closer than 10 feet of any property line. The communications tower is to save one total space for E911, Public Works, Police Department, or other public use at a height of at least 80 feet, and offer the use at no charge to the town, including no installation cost. And this is the section that the applicant has added, A, B, C, and D. The town's use of the monopole shall be in accordance with the Verizon Wireless Co-location Guidelines. B, the town shall provide proposed equipment, weight, and specifications to Verizon within 30 days of approval of the application, and the town's use is subject to the structural capacity of the approved monopole without the need for extensions or structural modifications. C, the town shall enter into a non-transferable, no-rent license agreement with Verizon Wireless, allowing non-commercial use for emergency communication services, public works, and other public functions at a mutually agreed location on the monopole and the related ground space for the town, not to exceed an area of 10 by 10. And D, the applicant will at no charge install only the lines and antennas onto the monopole for the town if done prior to the applicant's completing construction of the tower, and the town will perform any needed groundwork at its own expense. Number four, you should all have a kind of a site plan engineering package in your package. It says, number four is the structure and site are to be developed in substantial conformance with the presented drawings, Verizon Wireless site, Corning, New River Valley Mall by Thompson Litton. Engineering plans, number five, engineering plans signed and sealed by a licensed engineer in the state of Virginia shall be submitted to and approved by the building official prior to the issuance of a building permit. On the microphone there, sorry. Number six, the structure shall conform to section 30-200 telecommunication structures of chapter 30 zoning, as well as chapter 6 antennas of the Christiansburg Town Code, Virginia Uniform Statewide Building Code, and any other relevant regulations. Number seven, the structure shall not have lighting unless required by the FAA or FCC. And this pole, 125, is not required. I believe it's two. Okay. Eight, the structure shall not have any advertising displayed. Nine, all wiring will be internal to the structure. 10, the tower and all associated equipment shall be fenced with a minimum 8-foot tall privacy fence. 11, the landscaping requirements of section 30-200A9 of chapter 30 zoning of the Christiansburg Town Code are waived in consideration of conditions 4 and 10. And basically what that says is they have their own landscaping plan, so we just felt what they presented met the intent of the landscaping ordinance, so we just took the plan, the landscaping plan shown.
And the recommendation was for approval?
It was for approval, a 5-1 vote, and two abstain.
Okay. We have the chairman of the planning commission here. It's always good to hear you, Mr. Connor, but if you want him to...
Apologize there. Do you have any questions on either of those first two there?
What, they said that they're going to probably put it in there
next 6 months? I believe so. All right, moving on to number C there. And this is a conditional use permit request by Dan Steinberg. Whereas the Christiansburg Planning Commission, acting upon a request by the Christiansburg Town Council to study a request made by Dan Steinberg, acting as agent for property owner Lloyd D. and Mary E. Birch for a conditional use permit for property at 3145 North Franklin Street, tax parcels 406-4-22 and 23, for manufacture and assembly of smoking pipes and accessories in the B3 General Business District, has found following a duly advertised joint public hearing with council that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit the issuance of a conditional use permit to Dan Steinberg, acting as agent for property owners Lloyd D. and Mary E. Birch for property at 3145 North Franklin Street, tax parcels 406-4-22 and 23, for manufacture and assembly of smoking pipes and accessories in the B3 General Business District. Therefore, be it resolved that the Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends that the Christiansburg Town Council approve the conditional use permit with the following conditions. And there are three conditions. The operation is limited to not more than 25 employees total on premises at any one time. The permit is subject to inspections and approval of the facilities by the fire marshal and building official. And number three, the permit shall be subject to Planning Commission review in 1 year. And that was all in favor of that. A unanimous vote on that recommendation there.
Okay, and D?
All right. D, this one, dealing with the ordinance there, council's intention to adopt an ordinance amending Chapter 26 of the subdivisions and Chapter 30 zoning. Whereas the Christiansburg Planning Commission has found, following a duly advertised public hearing on December 7, 2010, that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit council to adopt an ordinance amending the Christiansburg Town Code. Therefore, be it resolved that the Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends to the Christiansburg Town Council that Section 26-7 of Chapter 26 subdivisions of the Christiansburg Town Code be amended as follows. And that is what you actually have in your packet. And that is our recommendation there, which is a variation of the secondary street acceptance requirement. And Randy has put together another chart behind that that you see compares the secondary street acceptance requirements with our changes here. So we've gone through and did you want to walk them through? Would you like for him to walk through that as part of this here?
Give us that comparison, yes.
And one simple question.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, is this what we got, is what Randy gave us just a moment ago, is this exactly the same as what was in our agenda packet?
No, it's not.
Okay. Then, okay.
It was modified yesterday. We had Planning Commission's work session. Yes.
Very good. Okay, thank you.
Two versions you have in front of you, labels 1 and 2, basically the two draft ordinances. It's probably not, I guess, common things with both versions of the ordinance. Both would require connectivity index requirements for new streets, and that's per secondary street acceptance requirements. Both would allow street sections otherwise approved by town council. That's not in secondary street acceptance requirements. I just included it in the drafts for wiggle room should council desire it. You can accept streets, either basically you've got a choice of accepting 30-foot pavement or accepting secondary street acceptance requirements. There are provisions for individual street approval through VDOT, but that's done on a case-by-case basis. That's the reason I worded it that way. They both require no greater than a 12% grade than otherwise approved by town council, and that's rather than the 16% grade allowed under secondary street acceptance requirements. The town currently uses 12% standard now. Both would disallow garages and carports counting towards off-street parking requirements. I know that's been mentioned during Planning Commission. I think Council felt that was a good idea. As mentioned by Council, both ordinances now disallow staff parking from counting towards off-street parking requirements. Both would require town sidewalks detailed to go to 5 feet rather than town current 4 feet, and that's part of secondary street acceptance requirements. They would require all street sections with no on-street parking on one side of the street, and all one-way streets to be approved by town council. That was suggested at the Planning Commission meeting, and they did recommend that in both versions. Developments with proffered plans would be considered grandfathered, and that's per secondary street acceptance requirements, and site plans under current review would be considered grandfathered. Couple of the differences between the versions. The version one is more of a straight acceptance of secondary street acceptance requirements, although it is tweaked a little bit. This version
would apply to new streets in all zoning districts, and it would require sidewalks or an 8-foot trail. It would allow developers to make the decision of sidewalks versus a trail, allows ditch sections with sidewalk installation, and that would be at the developer's discretion per secondary street acceptance requirements, and all street sections would be based on secondary street acceptance requirements. The second version requires sidewalks or a 10-foot trail for new streets and all multifamily development, and that would be regardless of whether a new street is being built or not. So if you've got an existing street with its own multifamily, you still have to install either sidewalks or a trail in the development.
Randy, can I cut it?
Sure.
The Huckleberry, what is the width of it?
The town portion's 10 feet. Yes, I think at least portions of Blacksburg and county are 8.
So 10 is what we're working with basically now?
I'd say for Huckleberry, we would want it to be at least 10. I think county and Blacksburg both wish their sections were 10. And I think occasionally we heard comments that maybe it should be 12.
To be defined as a multi-use path by VDOT is 10 feet. A multi-use path is defined by the department as 10 feet.
Secondary street acceptance requirements listed 8 feet.
Really?
Yes.
Thank you.
The second option requires mixed use in sidewalks in mixed use areas and also requires planning commission approval for developers choosing the trail option. That was discussed by Planning Commission, and they felt if you wanted to choose the trail option, you'd have to come back to Planning Commission for special approval. I think part of the reasoning for that is connectivity of trails was, I think, the largest reason, because you could have single-family development install trails and not necessarily connect to the adjoining properties. The second option requires curb and gutter with sidewalk installation. It also requires 40 feet of pavement in business and mixed-use districts and 30 feet for streets not classified as local streets.
Randy, I had one question. First off, I appreciate you doing all this. It's a lot of work went into this. Under version 2, the very first section there, differentiating that from version 1, requires sidewalks or a 10-foot trail for new streets, so on and so forth. Am I understanding that correctly as to mean that you've got an existing street and you've got a modification on that street of a particular house, there's a requirement that they're going to put a sidewalk? Basically, a sidewalk to nowhere on that particular street, or how am I reading that? I hope I'm not reading that way.
If it's a modification for a street, we wouldn't consider that a new street.
Good.
It would be a new street dedication.
Okay. So it's another way, it's not going to create that situation, in other words.
That's correct.
Okay.
If it's existing street, it would not be fall under the secondary street acceptance requirements.
Okay. Thank you. I was hoping I was reading the wrong way. I think I was not understanding.
Other questions?
Just for what it's worth, also, under both versions, how many site plans do we currently have that are under review?
There is a list of plans that are either grandfathered because they've already been approved, or they're part of a proffered plan, or site plans that are under review.
Thank you. It was right behind it. I just had flipped over. I see it. Thank you.
Is this the time to discuss it, or are we going to wait and discuss it
later? We'll discuss it after.
The recommendations, right?
Yeah, once we get to the vote or a motion to either approve or not approve, or accept or not accept.
I likewise appreciate the additional effort in good presentation tonight and the work that's led up to it.
It's been a difficult assignment for the Planning Commission. We do appreciate the additional work. Okay. We have on the agenda this evening Ms. Ann Thompson with Tri-Adventure Fitness in Action Triathlon, who is going to address council on a proposed triathlon to take place in June. And Ms. Thompson, you can introduce your assistant.
Kelly McPherson, she's my assistant. And we just wanted to, we were approached by the Aquatic Center at one point after it opened to have a triathlon out of there. I know the area has tried to have one in this area for a couple of years now, and it hasn't gone through for various reasons. The facility was not finished, and we're excited to have one. We think it'll be good for the community. We've already discussed it and gone over our plans with the town police and the sheriff's office. The company that we're working with set up events has put on numerous events over the last 7 to 8 years. They're USA Triathlon certified, so they're, everything they have is covered. And we would just like to get approval to have that in the 26th of June.
Okay, and I understand there is some liability involved with having these events, with closing of streets and all. I'm going to ask Jim Gwynn, our attorney, have you given any thought to what the liabilities for the town might be?
You mean since I tried the case for Blacksburg?
Since you tried, exactly.
I think about it regularly here. And yeah, there are a lot of different things to do. And I think USA Triathlon puts out a fairly detailed set of guidelines, recommendations, or requirements, or whatever. And certainly, I would recommend that if the town's going to get involved in this, that the least level of safety that would be used would be the USA Triathlon. And anything we look at that and see that we need to do more of, we need to do it. But it's certainly an endeavor that can, you know, it can be great, and then again, it can be a tragedy. It doesn't happen very often, but you know, one thing I would point out is the town's involvement would generally not be included under its sovereign immunity. It's not considered something that would be immune for.
In other words, if someone becomes injured as a result of traffic problems, or
if they get injured as a result of something that was our responsibility, we will not have immunity for that.
That's right, and that would include manning intersections for bicycles and
in particular
and runners.
And just so you know up front, we've sat down with some officers and they've gone to the chief, and we actually made up our course routes with the Christiansburg Police Department, and they actually tweaked it for us to where they felt it was safer and where they could close lanes, and have given us a list of how many officers that they would require for us to have in certain intersections. So I feel like we've been very thorough as to the safety. In fact, the police officers were working with our cyclists, and so they've been involved in certain activities where they know what safety measures need to be taken. So we've put a lot of thought and planning into it with their input, so we feel like it's a very safe course.
So the approval of this request would involve closing of streets for a period of time?
On a Sunday morning. They were careful not to exclude businesses, although on a Sunday morning most of them that were going by would be closed. They talked about the police can contact neighborhoods so they know if they're going to be rerouted. They would be given phone calls in the weeks leading up to it. They were very proactive about letting the community know. And if anything was going to be shut down, that there would be an alternate safe route for them to get through. We made sure that rescue squad and nothing would be closed and they can't do their jobs. So they put a lot of thought into it.
Do you have any idea how many people would be participating in an event like this?
It would be between 500 and 600 people.
And the dimensions, it's going to be swim, bike, and run, right?
Yes.
How long would each one be?
It's a 400-meter swim in the Aquatic Center. And then they come out and go out depot to Mud Pipe, and it's about a 12.5-mile bike, and it's a 5K run, so 3.1-mile run.
And the bike will come back to the
Aquatic Center? Everything,
and
it will finish
run
there.
Out of there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it'll all come out the back way on the depot, nothing on... Just crosses
Franklin,
nothing on Franklin.
Right. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
I guess the last question is, what is your timeline? When are you going to have to, what's your deadline for getting it approved?
We would like, I think he said you had a meeting January 4th. The sooner people, the setup events will open the registration in January, and so we want to make sure that we have everything lined up before we have people sign up, and then we have to tell them, just kidding, we're not having it. So early January would be awesome if that's something you guys think that you can do.
Okay. Council's going to have a time to at least review the liability part of it.
Officer Ramsey had our proposal, and I believe that he passed it on to you, and it has our routes on it, so feel free to look at it, and our contact information's on there if you have questions.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right, thank you. Mr. Helms, can we bring this back for the agenda in early January?
Mr. Mayor, do you think Officer Ramsey could maybe even say a few words on our January, that first meeting in January?
Probably wouldn't hurt to get the police department's take on what's involved in having an event like this. Will it take extra personnel and all of those things? Okay, if you'll put it on the agenda then for January, early January.
Would it be appropriate for street committee to look at this?
Certainly, if we're going to be closing streets.
I would think that the police department within themselves would know that if they have helped to select the route, I would think they would, their discretion as to what streets we need to close would maybe enough. I'm not taking away from the street committee, but it's just one more thing that we will have to look at. If we've got their recommendations that, they recommend these streets and they can cordon them off.
Yeah, let's get information from Captain Ramsey with respect to the routes and naming of the streets that'll be closed, and before we take action, let the street committee review it.
With this triathlon, it'll probably start at 8 o'clock in the morning or earlier? Or
it's going to start at 7.
At 7?
Okay.
So 7 to noon?
The roads will not be closed for that whole time.
All right, I understand.
Yeah, that's too early for me, Councilman, so I'm not going to participate.
Okay. I know the other competitors feel good about that.
I knew better, but I didn't. Is there anyone else that would like to address council at this time? Ms. Newell?
Good evening, Council. My name is Tacy Newell. I'm a resident of 425 Arrowhead Trail, and I am still a downtown property owner. I have a tenant in a building now. There was some confusion on that. First off, I'd like to thank everyone again for your service, being somebody who's done this. I appreciate the extra hours you all put in, and it's the season of giving, so that's my gift of thanking you sincerely for your service. But I also like to come as a beggar and ask you for three things. One of them, and I've had some side conversations with some of you one-on-one, is I know that your plates are full right now, but if there's an opportunity for a revisit on the historic districts, I ask because the building that I own downtown is a historic district. It's a historic building. It's not in a district. It's adjacent to. And I had hopes that when the Planning Commission looked at that they would consider the three separate unattached districts and perhaps look at what the State Department recommended with defining boundaries, doing an overlay. And if those, you have three separate historic districts, an overlay with defined boundaries would make it a historic district overlay. And in doing that, had you done that, it would have opened up access to state dollars if you defined the boundaries and said, here's our review requirements. And the review requirements could be, here's how you can get some additional dollars. Here's where you can go. So everything could have been back on me on where I went with no demands on what kind of doorknobs or facade or changes. So I'm prepared now because a decision was made on not doing anything on the historic district. I've waited 3 years, but I do have a building that I want to invest in. But you basically, by not having a historic district overlay, you've eliminated my contingency fund. I could have gone to the state and asked them to meet me 10 cents on the dollar for every dollar I was willing to invest. And this body previously granted me a conditional use permit, so it will be a mixed-use building. The downstairs is commercial, it's occupied. The upstairs is to be affordable housing. One of the other things that makes that attractive is that currently there's access to bus as well as post office, banks, parks, library. So I think it makes it very livable for people with modest incomes, and that's just, to me, it doesn't create a profit for me, but it allows me to preserve that building and provide an asset to the community. So my one gift that I'm asking you is to consider revisiting the historic district overlay. My attendance at those meetings and hearing the presentation from state partners was that the basic minimums were defined boundaries for an overlay and requirements, and that the requirements could be as simple and as just providing information. The other thing that I'd like, and knowing that the plates are full, is a consideration of looking at the status of the conditional use permits that are currently granted and whether or not they are in compliance. My understanding is that typically they're presumed to be in compliance unless there's a complaint, a specific complaint. One example that I would pull you back to is where Montgomery County came and asked that you forget Christiansburg's future land map in regards to property in back of the county government center, and that they're asked for a zoning variance to allow it to remain industrial, and that's adjacent to the Kiwanis Park. And there were conditions attached to that. It's been now at least a year, if not 18 months, and those conditions have not been met. And I know that that could well be due to budgetary constraints that the county is facing. So one of the things is whether or not there's possibility going forward, if resources, personnel, expertise, or money would allow you to do a review of conditional use permits and whether or not there are any that are not in compliance, and then what the steps would be to take to bring them into compliance. The last thing is I wanted to recognize you all. Most of you have seen me haunting these halls for about 5 years now, and I know that there's been a lot of transitions. We've got a new chief of police. He's been around long enough. I was honored to participate in that hiring panel, and I think that he's done a wonderful job for the community. He recently did a community speaking event talking about the wealth of resources that were out there, and it was nice to see him so comfortable in his job that he really had his sea legs under him. We've had Valerie Tweedy come on, and I think that she's really made the council feel more comfortable with the budget process. You're now bringing on the priority-based budget. Is a good thing, which is a far cry from what we saw in 2008, where budget meetings were being held without the public being aware. We've also had the public information officer, and she's made me feel very welcome, very responsive. The website, Mr. Stipes pressed to have that revamped and brought up. So there's a lot of transitions, and my understanding is that there is an RFP out right now for what I call a headhunter, which is my first job. To identify talent to bring in a new town manager. And I would like to suggest that what council does is take their Vision 2020, the priority-based budget, spend the money if you feel that it's necessary. But I think that you have the in-house talent to make good hiring decisions, as demonstrated by the public information officer, the chief of police, and the finance director, which is a complex position. And I think that Mr. Helms stepped in as interim manager and is probably going to be the best choice that you will have for your next town manager, which my understanding would be the third town manager. And so I would ask you to think more about that RFP and whether or not you're not actually looking for someone who will be a replacement after Mr. Helms. Mr. Helms knows the nuts and bolts. You have a lot of transitions. You need somebody with that empirical knowledge of how things really work. And it's just a community suggestion from somebody who has an HR and organizational development background to ask you to consider when you're looking at those RFPs, is to consider that your interim may be your best selection now. Find his replacement for when he retires in 5 or 10 years or whenever you wear him out. So thank you, gentlemen, and again, happy holidays.
Thank you, Ms. Newell. Is there anyone else that would like to address council at this time? If not, then we'll close the citizens' comment. I'm sorry. I didn't see your hand up.
With my camera. My name is Carol Lundstrom, and I live at 630 Depot Street in Christiansburg. And I just wanted to say, since Stacy brought up the concept of Christmas and Christmas gifts, thank you for the ones that I've been given this year. We have the videos that are now available for citizens that are much better than the quality I could afford to ever provide. We have a website that is growing. I realize that there are still a lot of people who want this and want that. Takes time to do a web page, believe me, I've been doing it for a while. It is slowly growing, expanding, and that's exactly the way a good web page does do. You don't overnight throw everything out there. You need to go slow with it, carefully. I do think that the addition of Val Tweedy, and we have got a new PR person, Becky Wilburn, and acting town manager Barry Helms has created a major shift in what I'm hearing the public saying about the town. And to go along with what Tacy pointed out about Barry, I just got 3 phone calls today from people who said, I didn't think Barry would be okay, but you know, he's turned out to be a pretty good guy. I said, yeah, and most of the time, if you give just about anybody a chance and some time to do the right thing, they do. But anyway, on behalf of myself, send money. On behalf of myself, and maybe stepping my boundaries a little bit, on behalf of the citizens, I would thank the town council for the things that I've seen done, and to Barry, and to Val, and to Becky, and to the citizens who've taken the time, who've come forward and let their voices be heard, to possibly, in the very near future, not only do what Blacksburg's doing, but raising the bar and watch them have to jump for it. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lindstrom, and I don't know that we have ever publicly thanked you for videotaping our meetings and making them available to folks on the internet, but thank you for that, and we're pleased to have our newest man back there doing it, but we appreciate the work you did as well. Thank you. Now we'll close the citizen comment unless there's someone else who has their hand up or wants to speak. We'll close the citizen comment portion, and we'll take up the recommendations by the Christiansburg Planning Commission. The first was the request for Selco partnership by Verizon Wireless to amend Chapter 30 of the Christiansburg Town Code in regards to provisions for telecommunication structures. And you heard the recommendation from the Planning Commission to approve those changes.
I move that we approve the recommendation of the Planning Commission.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to accept the recommendation of the Planning Commission. Any discussion?
Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor. Let me begin by stating that I had a chance to get to speak with Mr. Calvin, and I appreciated talking with him today, and I certainly appreciated the presentation he made some 2 weeks ago. The reports that he provided us with, the pictures, is very thorough. It certainly made me feel very at ease with the information, because it's certainly something that I don't deal with every day. nor that maybe I'll ever deal with again. But there's a couple of concerns that I had that I brought to Mr. Cowan's attention, and one obviously being the aesthetics of the placement of this pole, this monopole of this 125-foot. Given the location where it's at, it's going to be extremely visible. It's going to be, I would imagine, the first thing you see from a multiple directions coming at that side of town. And directly behind the mall, we've got the Villas at Pepper's Ferry, who were notified because they're adjoining property owner. There's also other residential areas right there beside them. I'm not in a position tonight to support the request, not in a position tonight to not support the request. What I would like to do is to have the opportunity over the next couple of weeks to approach these citizens, and because they're the ones who are going to be dealing with it every day, to see what they think about it. There's more than just the Villas that are right there located in the shadow of this monopole. I'm very appreciative that in the future we're going to have the opportunity to utilize it for our, what I guess would be a flush mount antenna to make it a little more aesthetically pleasing with our emergency services building. And again, that I'm very appreciative. That's really going to help the town out when we go forward. But you know, my duty is to make sure that the citizens of the town, number one, assess the balance of necessity with what they want. I'd like a chance to be able to speak to a lot of more of the citizens that I've talked to at this point. I don't know if they're fully aware as to what's before council. And I think that it's my duty as a council member to talk with them beforehand, before I cast a vote. I can see myself supporting this, I would imagine, since the Villas people did not come forward and have a lot of concerns. But I'm not convinced of that fact tonight. I'd like to table this until the second meeting of January. It'll be January 18th. I think we've already heard that they're going to start in about 6 months, as whereas I know they want to be have this approved immediately. I don't see the harm in waiting until the 18th to either approve or disapprove of this. I think that would give us more time to get some more public input. Furthermore, I've also spoken with members of the paper. I'd like for this to kind of be put out there a little bit, seeking some more input. I haven't received near enough at this point, and given that we had the large meeting this past week on the priority-based budgeting, haven't had an inclement weather, haven't had a chance to get out there and talk, I'd like to have that opportunity, and I'd ask that we table this till the 18th of January.
Is that a motion?
Well, right now, we're talking about the ordinance amendment and not the conditional use permit.
Well, I join both of them together.
Yeah, but they are two separate issues.
They are two separate issues.
And
Howard, have you had an opportunity to go over there and see where the tower is going to be?
I have. Well, I live right close to there.
I mean, the exact spot.
No, I have. Well, I mean, now I guess it's the exact spot.
It's right up.
You're saying the people in the Villas over there. I don't know this tower really. Now you're saying they will block their view.
I think it's going to be something.
I don't see how it will really affect.
It's not going to affect their ability to enjoy their. I mean, to live in their property. But if it's when you walk out your front door, your back door, and you see the 125 foot tower, yeah, I think it's going to bother some people.
Well, and it is a monopole, and yeah, I know it has an array on top. It is. It's different than a tower.
I understand. Yeah. And we've also spoken about the fact that it's going to be the tower on the top will not be flush mount, but the antenna on the top will not be flush mount. The tower situated directly beneath that, I'm sorry, the antennas, there'll be two of them situated beneath it, could be flush mount to provide a little more of a pleasing look to the structure. But, I'm not convinced at this point that I think the necessity, again, it may call for it. It may be an extreme need that we're meeting, and it is going to have some public utility going forward when we use it for emergency services building. But, I can be dealing with it every day, and I think that I'd like to get some more public input on it.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to see us separate the two issues. One is an ordinance amendment. The second is a conditional use permit. We need to address.
One is contingent upon the other.
Right.
The only thing that I could state in reply to Mr. Hall's recommendation is that we have a procedure for public notification for public hearings, and they're advertised in the newspaper, and I think ample opportunity was given for folks to come and speak to this issue, and we have to assume that when folks don't show up to speak their mind, that either they approve or they don't know. But when we put it in the paper and we go through the process of advertising, I would think that the community has had ample opportunity to know about it and to speak to it.
In response to that, though, I mean, I think that you're right. I think they either don't care, which may be a small percentage, or they don't know. And if we are, if this is something that's going to be worked on the next 6 months, number one, I don't see the harm in getting out there and having an opportunity myself to go door to door. And secondly, you know, the way I look at this, there's no going back. Once we approve it, it's there. And every time you go down that, come off Pepper's Ferry or go down Franklin Street or come off going from Blacksburg to Christiansburg, that's what you're going to see. And it's not that I'm attacking the necessity for it. I don't want us to put this cart before the horse and then be looking backward and say, you know what, wish I had more time to think about that. Because that's where I'm at this position at this moment. Again, Mr. Campbell's done a wonderful job of giving me information, but I just wonder how many citizens are aware of what we're going to be doing. And if, I think it's my duty to go out there and tell them. If I don't, I don't think it's because they don't care. I honestly think it's because they don't know.
Have we got any communication from any citizens, letters, emails, things like that? Sure, would it hurt to wait until the second meeting in January and let Mr. Hall do his
door-to-door? Thank you. There's a couple issues with that. One, obviously, this is one of our high priority sites. We'd like to get moving on it. 6 months to do it. You still got to engineer and design the tower, get the site plan, get the permit, turn in your engineering and all that work. And obviously, part of that time is that. And they'd like to get moving. This is a pretty major coverage you need. So from that standpoint, you know, we'd like to get going on it. And I guess we feel like if it's in the paper and the adjoining property owners are given notice and there's a public hearing on it that we've gone through that process. I've just not a huge length of time, but we'd like to get going and have that thing up in 6 months, not starting the 6 month process in a month or 2 months or sometime down the line. I think one of the more major concerns was the aesthetics of it and not having a tower that starts to look like a Christmas tree with too many things coming off it. And that one thing, I got an email and some questions about that from Mr. Stipes and from Mr. Hall. And then following up on that, I went back and spoke with our client about whether if we have a map that's shown in your drawing for Verizon, there are three other spots on that. The 80-foot spot is for the town, and obviously whatever equipment you have, which you can decide how tight you want to mount that or what you want to do. And there's potentially up to two commercial spots in between. And they were willing to add another condition to the permit that both of those spots would have to be flush mount so that we do keep a little bit less visual clutter, so to speak, in that view shed, given that we certainly acknowledge it. This is a property that's in a spot where it's going to be seen, and that look of that model home, keeping that tight, is something that seemed to be of some concern to some of the council members. So our preference would be to make that additional proffer to try and help respond to that aesthetic piece of it. And we ask that the council, if certainly we're here at your pleasure, but we certainly would like to see it move forward.
I got one more question. Is it typical for these towers to offer free space for the community or municipality?
It's not never, but yes, or typically where they're doing it. It's awful hard, quite frankly, to come in and ask for your approval for something and not cooperate if the town has made a request for some E99. Now, the specifics of that obviously can vary from place to place, but it is it's certainly not done on every town, but it's done on a reasonable number. Typically, if the municipality has the request, we're going to try and accommodate that if there's not some higher structure or some reason that you can't do it. And they normally will agree to that on terms fairly similar to what we're agreeing to do here for the town of Christiansburg.
Barry.
We requested on most of the towers coming to town after we learned that we could.
And this is something definitely we want when we build the future emergency services building on 114.
I call for a question on item 1A under discussion by mayor and council members.
Some of us haven't had a chance to say our speak our piece, but as far as calling the question, if the question is called, I will not support the request this evening. I feel similar. May I speak, Mayor, or is the question called?
No, we haven't called the question.
Okay.
We don't have a motion on.
Yeah, we have a motion and a second to approve.
But we don't have we haven't acted on any other recommendation, but we need to get this one cleared first.
That's correct. I came this evening after studying the issue carefully and also interacting with Mr. Cowan. I have concerns about the potential aesthetics of the structure itself, but I came prepared tonight hoping to delay a decision, delay action until next month on this so that we can have further questions answered and perhaps have some acceptable conditions to address some concerns. If it's only for one person, those aren't necessary, but if they would suit other people, then so be it, but they're aesthetic related. With that being said, the recommendation tonight, I have no problems whatsoever with a 125-foot tower, so long as every tower has to come before us for a conditional use permit. I would be happy to vote on the first one to revise our ordinance to increase the monopole height to 125 feet, knowing that every request is going to come before us for a conditional use permit. But I do have concerns about the potential aesthetics. The information's been thorough. It is a strong word. I won't use the word misleading, but the renderings do not show the worst-case scenario. The request is for a potential of four arrays on a 125-foot pole, and recently walking, ironically, in a different community and seeing a Christmas tree pole, I took a picture of it, and if y'all want to see that, I'll show it to you after the meeting. But that raised my concerns about no take-backs once we say yes. But anyway, I support the 125-foot pole. I do have concerns about the aesthetics. Those may be addressed with some statements about the flush mounts, maybe not on all of them, but certainly on, personally speaking, I wouldn't mind to have one array up there that makes it look like a tower and not an electronic Christmas tree.
So your comments really addressing B under...
Right. So that being said, I'd be comfortable acting on the first one tonight to change the ordinance to increase the pole height.
That's the only one we have on the floor right now.
Okay.
It's the first one.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And just saw the resolution of the Planning Commission tonight, and what I assume you're voting on is whether or not to accept the resolution. Have you had a chance to read it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that might... what you're saying here is we're going to allow them to be 125 feet, but we're only going to require conditional use permits if they don't exceed 70 feet.
Right.
So what you're saying is if they're 100 feet, there is no conditional use permit.
I understand what Jim's saying. I would make the argument that it doesn't say that communication poles are allowed by right anywhere.
Right. But, and Randy, what I'm saying is whether it says they're by right or not, the bottom line is you're saying here that communications monopoles not exceeding 70 feet with a conditional use permit. If they exceed 70 feet, they don't need a conditional use permit, right? Because you're saying they're 125 feet by right.
I would argue that it's not stated that monopoles greater than 70 feet are allowed.
In the definitions, it is, Randy. You change 70 to 125.
I understand what you're saying, and I can see that you could get an argument on that.
Well, I'm not in the habit of writing ordinances that create arguments. Well, I try not to. I mean, that concerns me.
Okay, thank you.
I mean, there's a quick way to fix it.
The way I read it was anytime you have a monopole that you're going to have a conditional use permit. But
then you wouldn't need the not exceeding language. That's what I guess that's what I'm trying to say is if you're going to have it for every monopole, then it doesn't matter the height. You're going to have it for every monopole.
So you're saying,
or you're going to have
by saying not exceeding 70 feet, you're inferring that anything less than 70 is acceptable.
Right. Actually, it's the other way around.
Yeah.
When you say not exceeding, what you're saying is if you bring it in at 65, you got to have a conditional use permit, but 85, you don't.
Interesting.
So if you say communications monopoles exceeding 70 feet with communications permit, then you're saying you can have one by right up to 70, and then after that we have to have a conditional use permit. Or you can just say communications monopoles with a conditional use permit, and you can control all of it.
Up to 125 feet.
Right.
So there's a cap.
Right. Well, if you want a cap, I mean, if you're gonna review each one of them, you don't necessarily have to have a cap.
Monopoles are allowed in all zoning districts, all districts in town. Planning Commission's desire was to limit them in residential districts only to 70 feet.
Okay. So what you're saying is, in the residential area, if they're going to exceed 70 feet, we want to have a conditional use permit.
If they exceed 70 feet, it's not allowed in residential. It's the intent.
Right.
That's not what it says.
The way our ordinance is written is exclusive. If it's not right. listed in the zoning ordinance, it's not allowed.
Right. But
someone would request a monopole greater than 70 feet in a residential district, I would say it's not a permitted use. It's not listed as a permitted use.
All right.
But we're talking about general business B3.
It would be. Probably be cleaner. There's probably a way to make it cleaner.
If the attorney would recommend an idea, but the way it reads, it says single self-supporting pole for the erection of communication antenna not exceeding one-third of the height of the main structure above a roof support, or 70, and we're striking that and making 125 feet.
Right.
So it means we're allowing a higher.
Except what Randy's saying, and we don't have in front of us, is the code section that says that they're not a permitted use.
Just an example, B3, it'll say communications monopole with conditional use permit, period.
Right.
No height limit specified.
It sounds to me like this needs some work anyway, then.
I mean, I think that's what we probably ought to do, isn't it? I mean, is there a section? Yeah, I mean, in our residential, we have the permitted uses, and we have the uses on conditional uses with a conditional use permit. Are monopoles listed in the conditional use permit? Is that where we're
They aren't separated. They're just permitted uses, and each use will say either it won't have anything behind it, or it'll say with the conditional use permit.
Right. Okay.
Hey, you have a motion on the floor.
I think it's going to lead to some confusion.
Yeah.
Did you just move the modifier and move the not to exceed to after the height? That'll not fix it.
Now, can we do that by amendment? I would certainly hope so.
Well, I mean, you
can move the modifier.
You can pass whatever ordinance you want to pass. You've given a notice. You can pass an ordinance. Whether or not it's the exact ordinance the Planning Commission recommends doesn't matter. I mean, you can always pass the ordinance in a form that suits the council.
I'd like to see it tidied up. And since there's confusion among ourselves, I mean, just from reading it, that doesn't make sense to vote on something that we're not clear on what we're voting on.
Let me ask you a question, Randy. Let's look at rural residential, for instance, and it has that last sentence which says communications monopole not exceeding 70 feet with a conditional use permit. What we're saying is in rural residential, you cannot have a monopole without a conditional use permit, and with a conditional use permit, the maximum height allowed is 70 feet.
Right.
So the wording there should be sufficient, should it not?
Well, the problem is, And I guess reading it all together, you allow them the definition of a communications monopole up to 125 feet. So what happens to between 70 and 125? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I see what you're saying.
And if it were, you know, if we were sure that, you know, if it ever was challenged, that the court would agree with us, be one thing. But it's a little bit you don't want it to be ambiguous if you're in that situation.
I can honestly see the way Randy's reading it to be appropriate, but the fact of the matter is if there's enough for us to have a discussion here at this table, then there's a question there that needs to be answered.
And maybe it's just addressed in a different section, and maybe not having it here or whatever, or maybe not having it.
The way all non-residential districts read currently is the main reading would be communication monopoles to allow with the conditional use permit.
Right.
I'm actually comfortable with the subject matter on here, but I'd like it to be perfectly clear.
Yeah, I mean, we could.
I'd like there to be no doubt as to what we're voting on exactly, and that it's the best wording.
If you did them all with conditional use permits, I wouldn't have a problem with it. And if you just took out the height part and said we're only going to allow them with a conditional use permit, then you can deal with, because you say up to 125 feet, then you can deal with whatever height you want it to be.
I see what you're saying. Just take the height out.
Yeah.
And
have a model of conditional use permit.
Yeah, and all other conditional use permit.
That was disgusting.
In the residential.
Well, we have three. We were given three potential ordinances.
Yeah. Jim, pardon me.
And this doesn't match any of the three.
Jim, we need to change tape, so just freeze in place, everybody.
Ordinances, but I did not get the resolution until tonight.
Right. So, really, you didn't have a chance to catch that.
Right.
Until after the meeting started.
Got a simple solution. If you look under section 3200A2A, there's a provision in there about height that's being amended. You could add a second sentence to that statement saying, communication monopoles shall not exceed 70 feet in residential districts, period. And then just strike that provision about the 70 feet in residential districts. Just state that it would require conditional.
We could do that. Yeah. That worked too.
All right. Well, we could do that by amendment and proceed if you choose to go that route.
So that means every pole monopole would come before council for conditional use permit.
That's the case right now.
Yeah.
Right. That's in the residential
area. That'll continue.
But that would clear. That would be clear with the suggested change.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would amend my motion to include that modification.
Right. And the amendment states
what Randy said, that the height of monopoles in residential districts shall not exceed 70 feet. And then are we going to take out the not exceeding 70 feet part? May as well, yeah.
Yeah. In each of the sections.
Right, in each section. Yeah. That'd be 3031, 3039.
Throughout.
Right, 3048 and 3059.
2331, 39, 48, and 59. Mm-hmm. You could actually strike all those sections because the way they read now is communication models. With a conditional use permit.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Ms. Clark, did you get that amendment?
Yes, sir.
Right. We didn't have a second, I don't believe.
Somebody did.
Mr. Hubbard.
Mr. Hubbard, you seconded. Uh-huh. Okay. Any discussion on this amendment?
Well, Mr. Mayor, I off onto another tangent here. The way I understand it, there are four towers in this area. There are two in Blacksburg, and then there are two in Christiansburg. This would be the fifth tower. We need to have a tower in that area, from what I've heard, to be able to communicate and connect all four towers. And so a tower is going to need to be built or put up somewhere in this area. And I think also another thing to think about is the community college is there, and they need additional support. And also, eventually, we're going to be putting a fire department down there on 114, and that will be highly used there. And that is really what did my vote. And I think that's something to consider, knowing that a tower needs to be built somewhere in that general area.
Okay, we have an amendment to the motion that has to do with the height. Ms. Clark, do you want to read back to us what you've got so they'll know what they're voting on?
Not really.
Does anybody have a question on it?
Yes, I will. And I do need to check with Randy to get the exact paragraph that he noted where we need to change the wording to say that monopoles not to exceed 70 feet in residential areas, which they're not allowed over 70 feet anyway in that zoning district. So I'll need to get some finer details from him.
Okay. It's at the end of section 3200A2A.
Okay. I just want to make sure you understand what you're voting on. Are you ready to vote on the amendment? All in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Now we're back to the original motion. And that is the recommendation by the Planning Commission that we approve the ordinance that amends Chapter 30 of the Christiansburg Town Code.
I move we accept their recommendation with amendments.
Okay, we can do that. A motion to approve with amendment. And did I hear a second?
I'll second.
Now, any further discussion? Okay, all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. The motion carries. Thank you. So we do have an amendment, or we do have the change in the Chapter 30 zoning. Now, contingent upon that approval was the request by PR Financing Limited Partnership for 125-foot communication monopole at New River Road and the tax parcels. And that's in the B3 General Business District. You heard the recommendation of the Planning Commission to approve.
I move we approve.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to approve. Discussion, please.
I'm not going to support the motion until, I in this case, I concur with what Councilman Hall said about a little more time to resolve the aesthetic issues with Mr. Cowan so that we don't make a decision that we potentially could regret, because the way it is now, there could be four arrays on that pole, and if you've seen one with four arrays, it's not a pretty sight, and doesn't, you know, that's a concern. So I'll just go on the record.
Okay.
I will not support the request in its present form.
Okay. Any further discussion?
I would concur with Mr. Stipes. I will not support the recommendation in the present form. Again, I think that this is one of those times where we've been given information that we have 6 months before they want to have something completed, and to give 2 weeks to 4 weeks for us to get a little more additional public comment is not too much to ask. I think we should table this till the January 4th, the January 18th meeting, to give us an opportunity to do that. This is not something we can take back once we do it, and it is extremely visible.
You're not suggesting another public hearing?
No.
I would like the opportunity myself. No.
Well, I think our procedure of notifying the public and giving them 2 weeks' notice, we've done that. It's a procedure that I think has served us well over the years. Yeah. Sure, all of us have been disappointed that time that we haven't had more participation from the public, but we can't really control
you
that.
You had a representative from the company here 2 weeks ago who stood at that podium for a lengthy amount of time, and you fired questions at him, and I guess maybe I'm a little confused. Why weren't these questions asked at that time?
I borrow an expression from a former president, but read my lips. If we approve this thing and there's four arrays put up there, this council will hear about it. And they'll say, what in the world happened with that?
And we should hear about it.
How did that happen? Because the rendering that was shown to us was a very simple pole with a simple array at the top. It did not look like a Christmas tree. And remember that we're having this discussion. If this council passes it, we will hear about it.
Mr. Mayor, if I could, pleasure of council, but one of the things we offered to try and address that without going back through the other was that we are willing to agree that everything below the top mount will be as shown in the drawing in the photo sims for the Verizon units, and modify, add a condition to the conditions that are listed that were read out from Planning Commission, that the ones below that any commercial use would be flush mount so that you wouldn't get the aesthetic concern that is here. Obviously, the town would have discretion with its equipment to do whatever it wanted to do, flush mail or otherwise. And our hope was that maybe that would help to placate some of those concerns. And we're certainly spoken to the client and amenable to that amendment to the commission use permit.
Well, thank you.
Makes council more comfortable to proceed. Obviously, we're here at your pleasure.
Well, we do have a motion before us to accept the recommendation of the Planning Commission. And we have several or two that have said they cannot support it. Is there any further discussion?
I would just want to remind council that I understand that our procedures are in place and they function very well, and I understand that. But this is a kind of a special circumstance. This is not as if we're looking to, you know, to rezone, I'm sorry, like a small property that we're not ever going to come in contact with, or it's only going to affect, you know, 20 property owners or five people along the street. Every day that you're going to be in that area, this is what you're going to see. And the property owners that live behind there, it's not 1 or 10 or 20. We're talking about large residential areas. I do not see the harm, and I do not see the fear that we should have in using a couple more weeks to really think about this. That is a lot of information we were presented less than two weeks ago today. You know, I simply don't see the necessity by this body tonight to act, which again is something we cannot take back. It's going to be in our face for the next for the foreseeable future.
It's going to be ex post facto accountability on
this one. I'm not going to argue that, but we have a planning commission that has studied this issue. They have met. They have brought us back a recommendation, and I don't know, it concerns me sometimes that the planning commission does the work and then we throw it back at them. It sort of sends a message, and maybe you don't have confidence in your planning commission.
That's not the message I'm looking to send, but I do know that when it comes to being accountable to the citizens, the planning commission is not elected. I am.
And you made your point very eloquently, Mr. Hall.
Yes.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Mr. Cowan mentioned that there was, that his client had either offered or suggested or whatever additional condition. Additional condition? Or is it covered in number four?
It is not. Number four limits the number of spots, but it does not require the lower ones to be the flush mats directly against the pole. And the motion that's before council does not include that.
So if you want that,
we can discuss that.
Motion and a second is for the aesthetically offensive Christmas tree version, potentially.
Well, since I made the motion to approve this thing, why don't you give us a drawing in 2 weeks as to what you propose to put up there, as it's going to be, and we'll act on it.
Chairman, I don't. It's first meeting.
First meeting in January. I want to see your picture. Is exactly what you're going to put up there.
Court would like.
And if we approve it, and it varies from that, we're going to tear it down.
Court, would that give you enough time to do it?
One thing with that, we can tell you what we're going to put on the tower, and we can tell you what the spots are, but we can tell you what, if we make a modification, that it would only be a flush mount and wouldn't be the ones that Mr. Stipes is concerned about. We can't tell you somebody's going to put anything on those lower spots.
True.
But that's your discretion as to the P911 spot that we've reserved, and it's whether somebody ever comes. The drawing you have is what we are proffering to build. And the only question is the two intervening commercial spots, do we restrict those to a tight one, which we're offering to do now, which would tell you that those could not be the broader Christmas tree, or do you, and that would be an amendment to what's before you now. So we can tell you what our piece of it is, and we can put that additional restriction on any other commercial carrier so that they can't build something large so you get too much of that. But we can't assure you that the second or third spots will ever be built, or that you all will ultimately put something on yours.
Yeah, and that's
that. We're happy to provide something.
That's not something we can address on tonight.
The restriction with an amendment to it probably just as well as the picture.
But by the, what is it, 3rd of January, the next meeting? The 4th of January? By the 4th of January, can you come back with a modified drawing showing those flush mount if they're ever installed?
Yes, sir.
All right, then if you're going to do that, we're going to need a motion to table until January the 4th.
I would make a motion that we table this discussion until January 4th, contingent upon receiving that particular etched or sketch drawing from Mr. Cowan.
And I'll second that, but also to give court enough time to get more citizen input.
Certainly.
What's wrong with the 18th? I won't be here on the 4th.
Yeah, I know.
Maybe that's part of the motion.
No. You know, it's we tend to leave a trail of dead horses on everything we try to do. Now, I think what you're going to get, if we go out and we poll the neighborhoods, we're going to get the NIMBY effect. Everybody on this end of town doesn't care as long as they got cell phones. Everybody over there doesn't want it. They want to put it over in somebody else's backyard. So sooner or later, we've got to bite the bullet. If this is the best place for it that triangulates or quadrangulates all of these signals, and we don't allow this to happen, the first time somebody's walking our new Huckleberry Trail needs a cell phone and doesn't have it, then we're in trouble. So I think it's a matter of not if, it's a matter of when we approve this. I think that it's needed. We've proven that it's needed. We know that for our own use it's needed. So I think January the 3rd or 4th is the time to make the call on it.
I want to respond to that. It seems to me that one of the issues here we're looking at is penetration in buildings, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right now there is service on the Huckleberry Trail. There is service, at least in my opinion, from the Blacksburg line all the way up to where it ends in Christiansburg. We're talking about penetration in buildings. So this is not something to where, you know, we're worried about someone having an emergency situation on Huckleberry not being able to get out. They can get out. But I'll also remind the council that this is where the settled position is. The optimal position is on Corning, on that site. And that's not been approved, and that's gone. So this
right,
is kind of a secondary.
We've had an opportunity to discuss it, and I don't want to call a parliamentary issue here, but we have a motion to table, and that is a non-debatable motion, okay. And we need to vote. You're either going to table it or you're going to act on it tonight. So, Ms. Clerk, I'm going to ask you to call role of council on tabling this issue until January the 4th.
Okay. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huckert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
And the motion passes 6-0, and I'm not going to belabor this anymore, but I'm just going to make a general statement. When we have a public hearing and a recommendation from the Planning Commission, and then we say, well, we're not satisfied with the Planning Commission's recommendation, and we're not satisfied with the number of people who came and spoke or whatever, and we've got to go out knocking on doors to, it sort of defeats the purpose of the public hearing. So that's all I'm going to say on that matter. It'll come back before us on January 4th. All right. Let's see if I can find my place here.
C.
We're under C, conditional use permit by Dan Steinberg, acting as property owner for Loy D. and Mary Birch for the assembly of smoking pipes.
Move we accept.
A second.
Yeah. Motion to accept and a second. Discussion?
I just one question. We covered it last time, but these, they are not going to sell anything from that store. Is that correct? Or that location?
My understanding is that it is not a walk-in retail store.
Okay.
They will sell through the internet.
The internet.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
These are smoking pipes. They're not... They're not bongs. Smoking pipes. Further discussion. Now, Ms. Lindstrom was giving me the message. All right, all in favor of approving or accepting the recommendation of the Planning Commission on the smoking pipes, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
Please indicate that there was one no vote. Council's intention to adopt an ordinance amending Chapter 26 with respect to the adoption of the Virginia Department of Transportation Secondary Street Acceptance Requirements and Pedestrian Accommodation Street Actions and Parking Requirements. You've heard the recommendation of the Planning Commission.
I would move that we accept the second formulation. Yes.
The second version?
Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor.
And that's what the Planning Commission is recommending, is that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Motion and a second. Discussion.
I'd like to recommend, first of all, commend the Planning Commission once again for the extra work. I do like option two. I'd like to bring to council's attention just a few simple considerations. I have some concerns about requiring a potential developer to have to come back before either Planning Commission or Town Council to decide whether to use either a sidewalk or a multi-use path. And a multi-use path, as defined by VDOT, is a 10-foot path. In rare instances, it can be 8 feet. There's four different conditions under which it can be 8 feet. It can actually has good reason to also be 12 or 14 feet. But 10 feet is a good conversational minimum, I think, for a multi-use path or shared-use path, as is defined by VDOT. But particularly to the recommendation, I support the Planning Commission's recommendation with two exceptions. I don't feel that any request should have to come back before council or Planning Commission, as is stated in here, for whether a 5-foot sidewalk or a 10-foot multi-use path, either should be acceptable under staff review for appropriateness and so forth. And as it was mentioned, the concern with that coming back before to either the Planning Commission or the council hinged largely on connectivity of parcels. Let me find my notes here. Basically, I think we could avoid that by making it, let's see, that's option one. I get so much paper up here tonight. Okay, here it is. It's 5 minutes, isn't it, Mike? Basically, I had it written down. I can't find it now. But the multi-use path, if those were to connect to adjacent properties at the point where the street dedication is proposed to occur, that would address most of those concerns about having to come back before Planning Commission or Council. Is that correct, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we could, theoretically, we could still meet the intent of Planning Commission in achieving either a trails or a multi-use path section or sidewalk without having to come back before Planning Commission or Council. If we require that, if a multi-use path or shared-use path is incorporated, 10-foot multi-use path, that it would connect to adjoining properties at the same location as the proposed street connection would occur, which is all part of your regular review.
I think it's a good idea, not to cut in on you. I don't think there's going to be that much of different developers having to come in, and I think it's a good idea that the Planning Commission and us are aware of what developers are doing. So that's what I think is a good thing about this, is just to keep us abreast of what developers are doing on these multi-trails or the sidewalks. I think there was a key issue. We've been spending a lot of time on this, and just to sort of blow it off and let them do what they want to, I think we need to review it.
The last item is, there has been some worthwhile concerns about what happens with the secondary street acceptance requirements for streets narrower than 30 feet in width. We've seen some dramatic pictures of fire engines trying to get through. But anyway, we've sort of become spoiled as a community, as most have, with big, fat, wide streets, okay? But anyway, my point is, 30 feet, I would be comfortable supporting the request as it's written, but I might also recommend to council a potential revision that would limit the street width to, or the lowest amount of two-way traffic street width we would have is 30 feet. And that way, we would not be confronted with having to review on-street parking, as the Planning Commission has required now. If we use a 30-foot street section, then those requests also would not have to come back before council for streets narrower than 30 feet in width. Is that correct?
Essentially, under secondary street acceptance requirements, you can go down to 29 with parking on both sides of the street.
And 30 feet's a nice round number, and we're all used to it. Developers are used to it. It's still a reasonable, it's a, still a very good concession, too, because the present requirement is 40 feet for face-to-face a curb. That's still a reasonable concession to use some other width in the 50-foot right-of-way that we require for something other than vehicular roadway. But 30, that's just another possibility. But I would be comfortable to address concerns about streets that are too narrow, that 30 feet would be the lowest we would use. And the rewrite could reflect that. It would be secondary street acceptance requirements, but in no cases shall the street be narrower than 30 feet for two-way traffic. Does that sound reasonable?
That's fine.
Okay.
We charged the Planning Commission with looking at sidewalks and green space for new developments. And then we said, let's adopt the state requirements for sidewalk and street widths. I don't know that I have heard a lot of public input on mandatory sidewalks other than a petition that was circulating around Christiansburg about 2 weeks ago opposing mandatory sidewalks. And I guess maybe I'm a little confused. Are we saying sidewalks are mandatory for all new developments, either sidewalks or trails? And that's what you're voting on tonight.
Yes, that's what we are saying.
And Mr. Mayor, if I may respond to that as well. I got a couple of calls, quite a few actually, about why am I pushing this? Why are you pushing this, Mr. Hall? I haven't had a sidewalk in my neighborhood for 25 years. I don't want to pay to put one out there. So the misconception is that we're requiring sidewalks and not only non-developed, I'm sorry, not only proposed, but currently developed property. And I clearly set the record straight with these individuals. I said, no, that's not what we mean. We're talking about proposed developments and future developments. This is not going to require you to put a sidewalk in front of your home. Oh, well, that's okay. I thought I was going to have to pay $5,000 to have a sidewalk. And that's actually been a majority of the phone calls that I've received have been like that. And actually, I meant to set the record straight last meeting, and I failed to do so, but that was, I think, one of the misconceptions. And the second thing is, as far as the public support for sidewalks, the reason I have pushed this awful hard, and some other members of council, is it is the number one issue that came up with me, aside from open government, was sidewalks and lack thereof of public accommodations in general. I don't mean to use the sidewalk moniker as the catch-all, but during my campaign and going door to door, is people were wondering why we didn't have the public accommodations that other localities have. And that's where it got to me. And I heard it, if I said I heard it from 1,000 different people, I'd probably be underestimating it. But that misconception about this, do we don't want mandatory sidewalks, I think a lot of people think that it means they're going to have to be putting one in front of their house that they've been living in for many years. And I understand that. I would be very irritated as well if that was
when I read the petition as it was presented to me for my signature, which I did not sign it, was that sidewalks were going to be mandatory and they'd
everywhere.
Be built all over town, and that's just not going to happen.
No.
I want to make sure that we understand we're saying to developers any new developments is going to be sidewalks or trails. And during our public hearings, I fully expected that the place would be saturated with people in the development business who would have some opinion on that, but I didn't see them, so.
Okay. I found my notes, Randy, and just to get this on the record with the other council members, in the different districts where we're requiring the sidewalks or multi-use paths, it's supposed to come back to Planning Commission, just in lieu of sidewalks and curb and gutter, an owner or developer, the way it's presently written, before us is, shall provide a paved multi-use trail minimum of 10 feet in width connecting to the street right-of-way and to each lot within the development by a hard surface connection. And it says, with approval of planning commission. My suggested rewrite to that for council's consideration is, in lieu of sidewalks and curb and gutter, an owner or developer may provide a paved multi-use trail a minimum of 10 feet in width connecting each lot within the development by a hard surface connection and to the public street right-of-way at connection points to adjoining land parcels. And doesn't have to come back to planning commission or council. And that would, okay, but that's my suggested rewrite. That's it.
Could you point me to that section, Mr. Stipes?
Yeah, so it's on option 2, page 10 at the bottom. And for example, page 10 at the bottom under Rural Residential District R-1A. But the wording is similar in the different sections, and I'm just suggesting that we that the paved multi-use trail is given the same priority status as a sidewalk, because if we make a developer come back to planning commission or council to use a multi-use path instead of a sidewalk, how many multi-use paths do you think we'll have in town? Very few. No one's going to come back and go through the ringer again. I wouldn't.
I'm trying to envision how this is going to work. There's a site plan approval.
Yes.
And the multi-use path would have to be approved at the site plan approval.
Correct. It would either be a sidewalk or a multi-use path that meets those requirements. A five-foot sidewalk on both sides of the road, or a multi-use path that adjoins each lot and connects to the public right-of-way at the connection points to adjoining land parcels.
Okay. And so at the time of the site plan approval, whoever's doing that, whether I guess it's staff initially and then
Randy's staff.
Commission?
No, it wouldn't be planning
staff. Then at that point, you're going to say, oh, yeah, the path has to be on this side of the road because the adjoining property, the path is on this side of the road.
Yes, or in this case, under the current draft, you'd have to go back to the planning commission with the site plan.
Right.
To use anything other than sidewalks on both sides.
I just want to make sure we understood how we were going to keep one developer from saying I'm on the left side and the other one on the right side and who has to give and all that. So it'll be done at the site plan. Does that mean?
What this does is it doesn't show preference for sidewalks or multi-use paths. It gives a developer the options of deciding what they think is best for their particular site and the connectivity with the adjoining sites. And doesn't have to come back before us. It can go through the staff review.
I understand what you're saying, Mr. Stipes, and if that wording is changed that way, I can support the change in wording.
Was it your motion to support it? It's a motion
to accept the recommendation of the planning commission. If you want to amend,
we'd have to go back to the motion.
Amend statement. The recommendation, but if you want to amend the motion to include what Mr. Stipes has alluded to, and I'm going to make another executive statement here. We should get these things cleaned up before they come before council. We spend an awful lot of time discussing stuff that has already been discussed now for weeks.
This was just presented to us this evening, after the meeting started.
Well, it's still, we should be a little better prepared to address these issues.
Mr. Stipes' recommendation on change of wording is basically going to let staff make the decision, but it's going to allow them to look at it to alleviate the concern that the Planning Commission saw when they were looking at it by making it connect to the adjacent interface.
Wherever the projected street connection points are going to be on adjoining properties, if a multi-use path is used, and that will also have to make the connection at that point, which does make sense.
And that wording would have to be carried through in each of these sections.
All right, I'm going to ask a clerk, are you getting these changes?
You have two, right?
I had that and a 30-foot minimum street width instead of...
She has good access.
Do you want to separate those up?
C Stipes.
Yeah.
implications on it. So I'll get with him to get the exact.
Well, we need to.
C stipes or B stipes? All right. So, but counsel, do you understand what the motion, what the amendment is going to be?
Yes, but I think he had.
There's two things.
The first thing we've talked about is to give equal preference for sidewalks and multi-use paths by tidying up the language and making the connection points very clear how those would be made.
We can do that with
one. Okay, the second one is, and I'm not hung up on this, but for council's consideration, there's been some good discussion about street widths and how, if we get less than 30 feet, are we going to potentially cause more problems.
Sure.
So I'm suggesting suggesting that 30 foot be our minimum. It's secondary street acceptance requirements with a minimum pavement width of 30 feet or face to face if curb and gutter is used.
That's fine. Yeah. Although for secondary street acceptance requirements, allowing you to get less than that.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm making that clarification. We can use that, but we can also set a minimum of 30 feet without having to come back to council for anything.
Yeah. I would much rather.
I would support that.
Yeah. I'd much rather those decisions be made in-house than to bring CUPs back before council.
And come back for every proposed development that has.
And there's no need for that.
You could simply take out the references to the secondary street acceptance requirements and leave in the trail and sidewalk requirements because the town current standards 30-foot minimum pavement.
Mm-hmm. It's 40 foot for curb and gutter.
Right.
Yes, for standard curb and gutter.
And we're requiring now curb and gutter in our area.
I think the way you mentioned, I think, makes a lot of sense. I'd like to take those two amendments and apply them. I could certainly support that.
Yeah. Well, I believe that we can address this with one amendment to cover both of
right.
your.
Right. If everyone's okay right. with that.
Everybody's in agreement with that, and Ms. Clark, you've got the changes yes, then.
Okay.
Everybody understand what you're voting on?
Well, I do, but it does concern me about mentioning secondary street requirements at the state. Would that supersede anything we put?
They're not thorough and comprehensive there.
Under 30 foot, that's what.
We're going to put.
What you're essentially saying is, you're going to go with secondary street acceptance requirements to 30 feet.
That's right. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And with curb and guttering, 40 feet.
And we have in writing from the head of VDOT secondary or local assistance program that no review by VDOT is necessary so long as we're meeting the secondary street acceptance requirements. So that's another reason to leave that in there for maintenance money.
All right, I'm lost. Did we get the amendment?
We're good. We're good. But there was another concern about going less than 30 feet.
Who made the motion to amend? Was that you, Mr. Stipes, I believe?
I couldn't make the motion to amend because it wasn't my motion.
I would amend my motion, okay. Mr. Mayor, to reflect that we incorporate both modifications to the current proposal that have been articulated by Mr. Stipes.
Okay. And we did get a second on that. Second. All right. All right, if you're ready to vote, then this is the amendment that you're voting on. And that's the two issues addressed by Mr. Stipes, and I can't remember what they
were good to go. Exact man. We're good to go.
But the clerk knows. So all you know what you're voting on. All in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Now let's take the motion. And the motion was to accept the recommendation of the Planning Commission.
With the amendment.
With the amendment.
As amended. Further discussion?
Second.
I thought we had a motion.
We already had a motion.
We already had a motion. Yeah, yeah. We can't amend the motion.
Why not?
We
have 100 things sitting out there right now.
I know. But we'll entertain any further discussion. All right, let's vote. The recommendation for the Planning Commission, and you have it there in front of you, so you should understand. Ms. Clark, this is an important issue. Let's call the roll on this one, please.
Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hepburn?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
That's a 6-0 vote, and the motion carries, and that's a very important piece that you've just passed. All right. Mr. Barber, do you have information on the Community Housing Partners loan request?
I do, Your Honor. We've discussed this thing a couple of times today and in the past, and in light of some wording in our original note and deed of trust that is specific to the use of the land that we have this first deed of trust on, we have contacted Community Housing Partners. The only way that we can get out of this, not get out of, but the only way this thing can be changed is if the state approves, I guess, abandoning the purpose of the grant loan that they did. So we are going to permanently put this thing on hold until such time as Community Housing Partners can come back to us with a letter clarifying the position. And at that point, when they get that done, and they're not in a major hurry to do this, so they will get it done, but I would ask that we table this thing until further notice.
Okay, let's put it off to another time. We want to make sure that we're not committing ourselves to something we don't want to, that might come back to haunt us. So I think putting it off is a good idea. The last time we talked about a representative to the New River Valley Emergency Communication Regional Authority, and Mr. Helms is our representative, and we need an alternate representative, and I believe we do have a recommendation. Mr. Helms?
Adam Carpenetti.
Who is one of our associates here, exact title being?
Assistant to the town manager.
Assistant to the town manager. And we'll need a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Mr. Carpenelli to be our alternate. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carries. And thank you, Mr. Carpenelli, for your willingness to do that. Recommendation to the plan to the Montgomery County Board of Supervisors for Christiansburg representative to the Fire and Rescue Commission. Yes. We have the chairman.
Hazard mitigation.
All right, we'll come back. We have with us Mr. James Epperly, who is currently serving as chairman of the commission. And this is a three-year term, and his term is expiring. And he has indicated a willingness to continue that job pending your approval of his recommendation to the Board of Supervisors.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second to recommend Mr. James Epperly.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to say that I got a phone call from Mr. Epperly, and we spoke about it, and his knowledge on the subject is, in my opinion, is fairly immense.
Oh, yeah.
He strikes me as somebody who not only can...
he knows it all.
I haven't heard it expressed quite that way, Mr. Hall, but yes, he knows.
But he certainly enlightened me over this course. I probably kept him on the phone longer than he wanted to be, but I think it's a wonderful appointment, and to continue that appointment, I would certainly be supportive.
He also talked to me, Mr. Mayor, and... he certainly is certainly knowledgeable, and he's interested, and I think that's the two important keys right there.
Yeah, he's certainly done a good job for us over the years as our chief of the fire department, and has served on any number of committees, and has been our emergency services person for many years. And all we need to do is act on this. All in favor of recommending Mr. Epperly for this appointment, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. A letter will go to the Board of Supervisors recommending his appointment. Thank you, Jim, for agreeing to do that. Now let's go back and look at the hazard mitigation plan. And Mr. Helm, you're going to have to help me with this one.
Okay. The Planning District Commission has done a regional hazards communication, hazards. Yeah. Hazards mitigation plan, and it's being reviewed now. It's been in place for 5 years. Time for it to be reviewed. They are working on each section. Our section, I've handed out a copy of what it says for us. Sent you a link to the
Planning District Commission's webpage where it has the rest of the plan. And next meeting, we'd like to see if y'all have any problems with what's been presented. You'll have to go from them to FEMA, and once it comes back, they'll come, we'll need to do a formal, after FEMA reviews it and approves it, then they'll come back for a formal approval from the council for adoption.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Helms. And this has to do, just such things will be covered as floods and storms and droughts and earthquakes and tornadoes. And
got landslides in there, too.
Okay.
Famines.
Famine.
It was interesting.
Any of you would like to take that FEMA course that addresses these emergency situations, we'll put you on the internet and let you take those courses. I finished just about all of them, but it's a lot to it. We need to take any action on this, Mr. Helms?
Yes, sir. So if next meeting, if you have any objections or comments to the plan.
All right, so it'll come back to us.
Okay. Pass it on.
All right. Pass it on to Mr. Helms if you have any suggestions. We have with us this evening several folks whose terms are expiring on the Christiansburg Recreation Commission, and you had asked that folks that you appoint, you'd like to see what they look like. So these are three folks that have been with us for a number of terms on the Christiansburg Recreation Planning Commission. We have Doris Oliver. Doris, stand so we can see you. And then we have Jim Williamson. Jim, you don't have to stand. You're so tall, we can see you. And then we have Michael Sayers. And Michael has been our representative on the on that commission. And they all have agreed to accept another appointment, which is it a three-year appointment? Three or 4 years? Four-year appointment. So what's your pleasure?
Move we accept.
Second.
I tell you what, Jim is one supreme athlete, okay? He looks like an old man, but I tell you what, he could kill all of us. Being an official for him, I think these are brilliant selections.
Let me say that as the liaison to the Recreation Commission, that I have worked with all of these individuals for the last 10 years, and it's been a real pleasure. They are all very, very contributing members. They attend, and they are well-versed in the needs of our citizens. So I will just thank you for the recommendations, and that's what I would say let's do.
All right, all in favor of appointing these three to the Rec Commission, please say aye.
Aye.
And you talk about Jim Williamson, don't play basketball with him. He'll elbow you right in the
dirty.
Thanks for coming.
I don't play with Jim, but I've watched him play.
I have, and I don't anymore. So.
Thank you, folks, for your willingness to continue service. Appreciate it. Appointment to the Planning Commission to fill the unexpired term of Wayne Booth. And Wayne Booth submitted his letter of resignation. We never did act on it, so that's the first thing we need to do is...
So moved.
Second.
Motion to accept Mr. Booth's resignation with our appreciation for his service. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And then we have a position to fill on the Planning Commission. Now, the last time... we had a balloting with a point system to appoint four to that commission. And we had six people, I believe, under consideration. Is that right, Randy?
Yes.
And if you want to use the same formula for that, then it would be the next person, the next highest number of votes.
Right.
And that person would be Jennifer Sowers.
I think we've advertised that and we went through a thorough process, so I would be comfortable with appointing Mrs. Sayers to
that. I would too.
So I'll make that a motion.
I'll second it.
That was one of the best things you folks have done in a while, is go through that process. So. Motion and a second to appoint Jennifer Sowers to the Planning Commission to fill the unexpired term of Wayne Booth. And do you have the information when his term expires?
Not handy.
Okay. In my letter to Ms. Sowers, I'll state that. All in favor, please say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. Ms. Sowers will be our newest member.
Mr. Mayor, before you move on, I was thinking here, you can even see tonight, the Planning Commission sometimes takes it on the chin.
Yep.
And to me, I like Steve Simmons and Mike Bird are two other people who were on the Planning Commission a year ago. And it seems like they leave and we don't give them a certificate, we don't thank them. I would like to, you know, say that maybe we should give them just a little token of something, of our appreciation for what they have gone through while they were on the Planning Commission. I'm not sure how everybody else feels about that, but I think it'd be nice.
You talking about a resolution, or are you talking?
Well, no, I'm not talking about a resolution. Just a certificate, or I'm sure that you know, even us, just a copy and a thank you. Yeah.
A bottle of aloe vera.
give him time for his work.
Randy, let's you and I discuss what we can do to recognize. And I don't know how far you want to go back, you know.
I was just thinking these three, and we could just take that from this. You know.
All right, Randy, we'll get together and talk about that. I think it's a good idea, Mr. Hubbard. Thank you for bringing that up. Mr. Stipes, Mr. Van Hoosier, Street Committee.
Very simple one this evening, about as simple as it gets. That was a jinx, wasn't it? Is there just one?
The additional copy.
Okay.
The additional copy didn't get here tonight.
Okay.
I'll stand up and present it then. Basically, this is, which one is the Stellar One? This is Stellar One on this side.
So much for
this. This is right on along West Main Street. It's a building presently owned by the applicant, Mr. Clements, and the building actually is a long, slender building, like Ms. Newell Fouts's. And what's happening is there's an internal lot line. The property is going to likely be sold here. And there's an internal lot line that goes up through the building, creating a parcel right here, the present parcel here, and then a long, slender L parcel. And simply put, the subdivision is to vacate these two internal lot lines so that the parcel is only one parcel. So there's two parcels, and they're vacating the internal lot lines, two internal lot lines to make it one parcel. The staff can delete one, but they can't delete two. So it's about as simple as it gets. It's the two parcels going to one for a potential land transfer. Any questions?
Move we approve.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to approve this lot line division. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carries. Mr. Town Manager, you have a report for us.
Yes, sir. Two public hearings set. They're not joint public hearings, just public hearings for council. One is for vacation of portion of Farmview Road Northeast. We set that for the 18th.
So moved. Motion, second.
Second.
Second. We have a motion and a second to set that public hearing for January 18th. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Could have done the count.
The second one is in our PPEA guidelines. Before we can accept or sign an agreement with someone who proposes PPEA, we have to have a 45-day advertisement, and we receive the PPEA, and it's been advertised for 45 days. And then we have to have a public hearing before we can sign the agreement. And so I'd like to set that public hearing for the 4th of January, and this is for the Diamond Hills Park Stream Bank Stabilization PPEA. I'd like to set that for the next meeting.
So moved. Motion, second.
Second.
Motion and a second to set that public hearing for January 4th. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Please, have a copy of Our Health magazine, and just want to point out on page 36 that our Fifth Grade Recreation Center received an award, the Bronze Award for Fitness Centers, awarded by this organization. And then on page 42, under Senior Center, they received the Gold Award. So, I'm going to pass that along to you.
It's being best of the Blue Ridge. It's good.
And Mr. Price apologized for not being here this evening. He wanted to be here to present that to you, but we commend the Recreation Department and the Commission for that award.
And Mr. Van Hoosier, on the
we had given you some updates on the bus system, ridership and so forth before, and I had told you that we'd give you an update on the ridership for each month at the second meeting of the month for us. We received the information late this afternoon. Unfortunately, I guess we had a communication problem, and I'll try to rectify that tomorrow. But this ridership is through October, and I was expecting to have it through November. So what I will request of Becky is that she send us the ridership information through November and that she email it to each member of council so they'll have that. And then we'll try to have that the second meeting.
Yeah. Well, we have a work group meeting on January the 11th,
right.
I understand. You should be able to have more information after that meeting.
Now, is this on a percentage, or is this actual bodies that are on the
list? No, these will be, it's been body numbers.
Body count,
yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I'll email her tomorrow, because this came in late today, and see if we can't get it to us in the next couple of 3 days.
And while you're on buses, let's mention that beginning, I think, January 3rd, there will be a commuter bus that's traveling between Christiansburg and Blacksburg for people who work in the Blacksburg, Virginia Tech area. And I think that bus loads about 7:15 here in downtown Christiansburg and Cambria. And anyway, get that word out. If you live in Blacksburg, if you work in Blacksburg and you want to ride the bus over there, boy, this is a good service. It saves having to pay how much in rent, parking?
Over $200.
If we hurry, we won't have to change the tapes.
All right, let's hurry. We won't have to change the tapes. Anything else to come before council?
I've got something, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to go over the farmer's market that I've mentioned several times. And one thing I want to mention here, too, is, I've had a very good results on this. Lots of people have contacted me, and I think there's a lot of good opinions concerning it. One thing I'll mention, that the $1,000 that I think is in one of the articles, you know, I realize that nothing can be done without council's permission, but I'm hoping that maybe if the farmer's market is approved, maybe some money will be approved by council for advertising and promotion and things of that nature, and maybe down to the tourism budget. And the other thing I had on my mind here, this being the last meeting in 2010, you know, I hope that, you know, that we can all, for 2011, I think that was the motion I would put forward, that we all think about finances and we all think about revenues and expenses. And if we're not just thinking about it in, you know, April and May, but we're thinking about how we're spending our money throughout the whole year.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Huppert, and thank you for your leadership on the farmer's market. I hope it comes to fruition.
No pun
Folks,
intended.
No pun intended.